Hello, André. Thank you so much for joining me today. Today, we'll talk about a set of tools that you've built for testing blockchain. I struggled a lot when I was reproducing blockchain vulnerabilities with all the setup steps, different blockchains and everything. And from what I've heard, you created something that is supposed to solve all these problems. Can you talk me some about it?
Yes, of course, Greg. So thank you for having me. I'm the product owner of ZION, which is a virtual machine that includes all the tools necessary to do smart contract auditing. And you can have a chain in Solidity, so EVM, Rust, Solana, Polkadot, Substrate. We have all those protocols already integrated and all the tools to audit them.
Awesome. Sounds awesome. So without further ado, can you show me how to find bugs with ZION?
Of course. Okay. So we have the null on CTF 2022, which has already been solved and published. So we are not going to spoil anything. If you look, you have two folders. One is the server and the other one is the solve. And then you have a script that simply compiles the solve and just run it. So if we look into the framework, we can run low-hanging fruit tools, for example, to find vulnerabilities in the crates, in the dependencies, or things like that. We have cargo audit. We have cargo Geiger for anything unsafe. We have Sidero Field for potential fuzzing targets, even though a manual review is always better for this. We have many other tools that are available, like Soteria. You have other things like that. So let's do, for example, a cargo audit. Well, and we'll see that it will find some vulnerabilities in the crates that this code uses, which is pretty common, simply because you have dependencies that have some vulnerabilities. It doesn't mean necessarily that your contract is insecure. For example, you have this one, the time, which is a potential seg fault, which is quite high vulnerability, yet doesn't mean that you are vulnerable to it. You have other ones, risk conditions, etc. But for each of them, you need to ensure that by checking the advisory, that your contract is not vulnerable through the dependency.
Yeah, that's great. Tools are always good starting points. But I imagine if it's not the most basic CTF task or in the work itself, we do need to do manual analysis. Do we have some tools in ZION to also do this?
Of course. So yeah, in most contract audits, this is just the first few tools that you run to get like quick, low-hanging fruits that are pretty standards into a report. But we have VS Code, actually VS Codium. So that way it is open source and with a bit less tracking than the Microsoft version of VS Code. You can see here by opening the CTF, that you have a library. You also have a main contract there. And basically, most of the time of the smart contract auditor will be spent in Codium doing manual code review. Because even though AI tools are big now, et cetera, nothing beats the human yet. So here you can see that you have a main program that is a server. It is listening on the port 8080, creates a connection. You can see that it initialized the environment, mint some token, and register an employee A, for example, from the organization product. It then deposits 1,000 token, mints 1,000 token, and deposits 500 token into that account for the employee A.
This is the account we don't have control over. Is it
exactly? This is the account that is created automatically by the program right now. So we have no access to it. We must create a new account. So once the setup is done for that account, we have now the player account, basically, that is that has 100 tokens. So 100 tokens is available to the player, and the goal is to get more tokens, obviously.
So how do we do it?
So that's a great question. How do you find vulnerabilities in contracts in general? Well, first you have to check the different functions of the contracts. So you can see that there are three main functions. One is register function after the initialization, of course. You can see that it requires the employee ID to be a certain length, the organization to be a certain length too. And then it ensures that this already exists. Otherwise, it is duplicated. So otherwise, it says that it's a duplicate employee. Then we have the register function, which We have the deposit function. Then it can deposit tokens to that employee. You can see that it requires that the employee is already in the system, and it checks that the employee record, the organization, and the ID is already there. Then it does the transfer, and it ensures that the vault amount is superior at the amount that we are actually depositing. Then you have the withdraw function, and same thing, it does the checks to be sure that this employee exists. It ensures that we can't withdraw more than what the vault has in the correct order. And it checks for the different seeds, and then it withdraw. If we go check the struct of those functions, you can see the register. It registers into the catalog the seeds of the user, checks the employee, that's the employee record. Now we're in the struct for the deposit. So we see that they have initialization if needed. So it creates the account if it's not already created. It seeds the account as organization name as bytes and employee ID as bytes.
What's a seed? What is it used for?
So the seed is used for the creation of the PDA, which is a program-derived address. So basically in Solana, everything is an account. And so the program has a PDA to do its bidding, basically, in terms of transfers. You can see you have different constraints here, that the employee record must be the organization name, and it must be also the ID. So we can't really fake the PDA. We can't really fake the token itself. There are some restrictions which prevent it to simply allow us to hack this. So if we run, for example, the script, which simply run the solve, we can see that the player has 100 tokens. That's our basic amount. So right now we don't have the flag or anything simply because we don't have more than 100 tokens. So in order to do that, we have to check how can we withdraw more without encountering those constraints. The key here is in the way that the seed is generated. So the seed is generated simply with org name as bytes and employee ID as bytes, concatenated basically together. So when you...
And if we predict the seed, does it automatically mean we can withdraw money from a different account, withdraw tokens, sorry?
Exactly. So we basically do some kind of seed collision by doing that. And you can see that the original seed, when you look here, is based on product and employee in the program by default. So to solve that, we need to reproduce this string, product and employee, together. Well, that's actually quite simple and at the same time a bit sneaky. And also something that the automatic tools wouldn't find. You simply need to first find the program address, which is with that seed, product, employee, and then into the solving program, which is here, you can see that that's where we at. We have employee B, and then our instructions go here. Well, we don't want to be employee B. We want the funds from employee A. So
yeah, but there was a check for if employee ID is unique, no?
Actually, yes, it is. But the seed itself is what allows the transfer. So here, if you change the strings to do this, it will work. Or you can also simply do that, and it will work because the seed at the end is the same when you add those two strings together. So
yeah, because there's a check if the employee ID is unique, but there is no check if these two things concatenated are unique.
Exactly. And that's exactly why it is vulnerable. So if we complete the withdraw function, we saw how the struct is and what are the parameters. I'm pasting here the different parameters for the account to withdraw, which is pretty standard there. And here we're going to withdraw 500 tokens. We could withdraw less if we want, but we know that this employee A has 500 tokens. Here, I just saved the files, and you can see that there's an error here. It's simply because we need to clone those variables, because in Rust, you have to borrow or clone the different variables. Now that it's saved, this is good. And if we run it, it should normally bypass the security and give us the flag, hopefully. And as you can see, this time we have 600 tokens and the flag is download Zion at zion.org.
That's awesome. That's great. And speaking of download Zion, how does this work? Is it a Docker image? Is it a virtual machine? Where do people go to install this and basically start testing Web3 vulnerabilities?
Sure. So we can download a VM directly. I will show you. So we go to the website. We click on download. We choose the architecture that we want. For example, Intel and AMD. And we want from the VirtualBox one because that's what we have installed. Double click on it. It launches VirtualBox. You can check the different parameters. You can adjust how many CPUs or RAM you want to put to assign to this VM, for example. And once that's fully imported, you can simply just start it.
That's simple and easy, just like I like it.
Yep. You simply double click on things and somehow it all happens.
Awesome. Looks really good. Thank you so much for joining me today and explaining to us how to use this. I will definitely use it the next time I'm explaining or looking for Web3 vulnerabilities. For people, they go to zion.org to install these tools. Is this correct?
Yes, it's correct. You go to zion.org and you can click on the download button just as we showed earlier. You can also register on our newsletter by going onto halborn.com and subscribing there. We also have a blog on the zion.org website, so you can check new content from time to time there.
Awesome. Thank you again for joining me today.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me, Greg.